Good evening and welcome to Dramalogue Talking Theater. We're thrilled to have you here. My name is Bruce Linzer. I'm the manager of the Drama Workshop here at Palm Beach Dramaworks. And we want to thank our sponsor for this evening, Martin and Marlene Silver. Thank you so much, Martin and Marlene. We could not do what we do without you. So we're incredibly grateful to you for that. Let me get my things in order here. So I want to tell you about a few things that are coming up. We're very excited about our next Dramalogue Talking Theater will be in 2 weeks, 2 weeks from tonight. That's December 18th. Oh my gosh, it's almost Christmas already. How is this happening? Friday, December 18th at 7:30, and that will be with Mark Perlberg. He is the Drama Workshop executive producer. He is also the former board chair for Palm Beach Drumworks. So we're thrilled to talk with him on Friday night, December 18th. We are also in the middle of our Home for the Holidays series, which is going great. I hope you were all able to see the trip to Bountiful this past Monday night. And then this coming Monday night, we have The Last Night of Ballyhoo by Alfred Urey. That's this coming Monday, December 7th. That is also at 7:30. As always, all of our programming is free during this time, but you do need to reserve your tickets online or by calling the box office. And then we take a week off, and we will be back on Monday, December 21st, right before Christmas, so that we can read you A Christmas Carol by Charles Dickens. I think it's going to be a wonderful, wonderful evening, so I hope you're able to join us for that Monday, December 21st at 7:30 p.m. Of course, tickets are free, but you do need to reserve those. Tonight's Dramalogue guest is the incomparable costume designer Brian O'Keefe. He's fabulous, but I'm going to let Bill introduce him to you in just a moment. In the meantime, I'm going to say thank you to the Tourist Development Council and the Cultural Council of Palm Beach County. They are supporting our online initiatives, and we're incredibly grateful to them for that. If you are in a position during this time that you can make a donation, we would certainly appreciate it. As I said, everything is free, but it does cost us money to do that. So if you're able to help us out, that would be fantastic. If you would like to underwrite or sponsor a program, we can do that too. Just reach out to Carla Bryant. She's our Director of Development, and she'd be more than happy to talk to you about that. There will be a Q&A afterwards, so get those questions ready. You can put them in the Q&A section, and then I can bring you in to talk to Brian all by yourselves, which would be awesome. In the meantime, please turn off your cell phones so that we stay focused on this screen, and not that one, and so that we stay in the habit for when we come back to live theater. Hopefully very soon in 2021, fingers crossed. And at this time, it gives me great pleasure to introduce you to our producing artistic director, Mr. Bill Hayes. Bill, are you with us?
Mr. Bruce, how are you?
Hey, I'm very well, thanks. How are you?
I am great. Did you have a nice Thanksgiving?
I did have a nice, it was very quiet, just the two of us. Well, three with the cat.
Did you cook?
No, please don't be
this
silly.
This is like
Danny's an amazing cook. Why would I cook?
This is like 2 years in a row that I didn't cook. Usually on the holidays, Sloan and I like to do an open house, and we both love to cook.
Yeah, you love to cook.
It's going to be kind of funky this year, especially for Christmas, which is my favorite holiday, of course. I want to tell people that I just talked to the box office, and we are almost sold out for Ballyhoo on Monday night.
Oh, cool.
We can only take 500 households.
Wow.
And we are almost there. So I want to urge everybody, if they would like to participate, to please contact the box office. We're not open on Saturday, but to contact them on Monday. And with the excellent news of all these vaccines in the works, we are absolutely convinced that we will be opening next fall. We will announce in January what the shows are going to be. You'll be hearing from us, and we're just really juiced up and excited about it. For those of you who cannot attend the theater, we do plan to film all productions in the future, and there will be an at-home subscription package. But I do hope that you will attend live so we can talk and we can hug and we can mingle. We're just really excited about opening next fall.
Very cool.
As you know, Brian O'Keefe is very, very special. He has designed 51 productions here at Dramaworks. He's only been with us, 5 or 6 years total as a full-time employee, but he has designed I think even more productions that I have directed or Barry has directed or That's Michael has designed as a scenic designer. He's very special. He's a gift to this organization. He has so many awards that he now uses them as paperweights. And I want to welcome to the screen my dear friend and staff, Mr. Brian O'Keefe. Hello. Hey.
Good evening.
How are you?
I'm good. I'm very well. How are you doing?
Good. Now, this week, I don't see a martini in your hand.
Well, I have the glass waiting. I'll be filling it after we're done. Otherwise, I would be falling asleep right in the middle of all this.
I have to ask, did you design that vest?
I did not.
No, this is,
but it has been on our stage.
It has. In what production?
This was worn by Tom Wall in Act Two of Billy and Me.
Wow. So do you steal our costumes? I'm just
curious. No, only borrowing it.
long term borrowing.
Well, you know, I know where to find me. So.
Well, I'm glad you could be with us tonight. Whatever the hell your name is, Brian.
I know you were going to call me Gary. I know.
I almost did, but you have to talk about Gary as much as he talked about you
in
his interview.
I'll try.
Bruce, thank you. Bruce is going to be our mission control and
thank
run the talk back afterwards. I almost called you Gary. In some ways, you're one and the same. You're just two extraordinary, wonderful human beings. As you know, for our 20th anniversary, we're paying tribute to those who've contributed to the success of Palm Beach Dramaworks, and you certainly have in a huge way. And I'm trying to remember how we first met, and we'll get into that. But you've designed 51 productions.
51, yeah. That includes concerts and the school. I designed one of the school tours, and so it's been quite a bit.
So the audience, of course, loves your work. They're huge fans of your designs, and they know you as they see you in the lobby. They mingle with you at some of our socials, but they don't necessarily know your background and your journey and what got you here today. So this is an opportunity to get to know you on a bit of a deeper level. You are a Virginia boy.
I am. I was born in a very small town called South Boston. It's right in Virginia from North Carolina, right in the middle of the state, just over the border in Virginia. And I'm the only member of my family that was even born in the South.
Yeah, I was looking at the history that you, three of your four grandparents were born in Chicago. Your parents were born in Chicago. Your two brothers were born in Chicago, and you were born in Virginia.
Right. Yeah.
So how did that happen?
Well, my father just kept going from one job to another, just sort of working his way up the ladder, you know, and switching from one company to another. And so we moved around a lot. They moved around a lot more before I was born.
Right.
There was one year that my brothers were in school in one school year, they were in three different schools in three different states.
Wow.
Yeah. So.
And you had moved a lot. If I remember, you lived in Virginia, and you went into North Carolina.
I went from Virginia to Princeton, Illinois, actually, and then to North Vernon, Indiana. And from there, that was when I was three. By the time I was three, then we moved to Asheville, North Carolina.
Which is beautiful.
It is beautiful. Yeah. We were there for a year. Then we moved slightly west to Bryson City, which was a very sleepy little town back then. Now it's a big tourist attraction. Right. All the Floridians go there now.
You and Gary regularly, I think regularly, go back to Asheville. Is that true?
We do. It's easier to fly into Asheville to visit my family in Lenore.
Okay, so you still have family there?
Yes, the rest of my family is basically in Lenore, which is east of Asheville, where I did most of my growing up.
Yeah. So how did that impact you, all that moving at such a young age? What kind of impact did that have on you?
it didn't impact me greatly just because I was so little. I really was so little. Like I said, I was only three when we moved to North Carolina, and we only moved twice in that amount of time, you know, after the age of three. So it didn't affect me nearly as much as it did my older brothers.
Yeah. So let's talk about your grandparents, the maternal Joseph Maszewski, right?
Did I get it right? That's pretty close.
Pardon me?
That's pretty close. Yeah.
Okay. Maszewski.
Maszewski. Yeah.
Good. Okay. I did it. I did something right today. And then his Jeanette, which is, was it pronounced Kabuki? Kubaki?
Kubachki.
Kubachki. Okay. Kubachki. I had to screw at least one of them up. And that is, she's from Poland. Your mother's mother's from Poland. And I understand she came here at the age of one and she did the whole Ellis Island thing.
Right. That's right. She did. Yes.
Yeah. And
I believe she got her citizenship in 1944 or something like that. 44, 40, something like that.
Was she part of a large family or not?
Let's see. She had a sister and I can't remember if she had two or three brothers. Mm-hmm. I know her father was a building contractor in Chicago after they came to the United States, but he died young, and her mother remarried. So when I was a child, I remember my great grandmother and my step great grandfather. Mm-hmm. Neither one of them spoke English.
So did you learn any Polish along the way?
My mother taught me how to count to 10, but
I'm still learning.
I can't say I remember. I don't remember it anymore.
Yeah.
You know, then, as we get older, we lose our memory.
I know. I have no idea who you even are.
Right.
And then your paternal grandparents, William Keefe.
Keefe, yes.
We're going to have to talk about that in a little while.
Yes.
And then Ann Keefe, and they were both born in Chicago, and there was a sad story there that they both died at a relatively young age.
Yes. As a matter of fact, I know that just before I turned one, my family went to visit from Virginia to visit in Chicago so that the grandparents could meet the new child. And it was maybe only a couple weeks since we had been visiting that my father's mother passed away from a heart attack 2 days before my first birthday. And then my grandfather, unfortunately, took his own life about a week and a half after my grandmother passed away.
You know, it's tough. It's tough to lose a partner. And I remember my grandparents went through that, especially when the woman goes first, because they do so much conditioning for the man to go first.
Yes, you know? I know. She took care of him. She did everything for him. So I think it was just an unbearable loss for him.
Yeah. So your maternal grandmother, I seem to remember Jeanette, is Jean.
Yes.
She was the one you were particularly close to?
Yes. Well, my grandfather, her husband, I, of course, knew until my senior year of high school. I didn't really get to know him all that well. We would go visit Chicago once a year, maybe once every other year while I was growing up. He was an extremely kind, sweet, gentle, quiet man. I remember him walking me to the corner liquor store to buy me an ice cream.
Oh, I was going to say, you started young.
not a beer. So when he passed away in 1980, my grandmother made the very bold move to, she made the decision to move to North Carolina. And she moved in with us for a few months until we found her an apartment. And
she would end up living 19 more years, right?
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah, let's look at some photos of your grandparents. You can introduce them as we show them on the screen.
So these are my mother's parents. So this is Joe and Jean. That's one of my favorite pictures. I like her smile. I have her smile, I think.
You do. And I even see your mother.
So this is their wedding in 1930.
Love it.
It looks like a beautiful wedding, doesn't it?
Is this framed at your house?
No, it isn't, unfortunately. I'm going to have to do that.
You're going to have to steal that. That's a great photo.
Yeah, yeah. These are my father's parents. So this is Bill and Ann.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. And it says, yeah, it was 1951 this was taken, yeah. So this, I guess, must have been some type of family party.
Looks like it was in the basement.
In somebody's basement, somebody's party room in the basement on the left.
Or they were bootlegging or something.
on the left is my father and mother. It looks like she's probably with child. Probably
what a handsome couple.
My oldest brother, probably. And then next to my mother are her parents. The little boy there is my dad's younger brother. And then the couple in the middle, those are my father's parents. And on the right is my father's older brother and his wife.
Mm-hmm. How many siblings did your dad have?
He had one sister who was the oldest, and then Bill and Bob. So
what about your mom?
My mom has one brother. Yeah, mm-hmm. So we don't really have an overly extensive family tree. Fairly small.
Right, and so your parents, John and Lorraine, they were born in the 1930s in Chicago. And right. Let's talk about John and Lorraine and what they both did for a living. And tell me a little bit about your parents. I know you're really super close to your parents, and your mom are glued at the hip, right?
Yes. Some people do refer to me as quite the mama's boy, but yeah. And I don't mind that. I love my mother. I love my parents and my family. We've always been a very close family. We haven't talked about my brothers yet, but they are 8 and 10 years older than me. So when I was growing up, you know, they were way ahead of me. So I spent a good deal of my childhood mostly with my parents. So they were easily my best friends, my playmates. So we were always very close.
I've known that for a lot of years. And I don't know if your mom is watching tonight, but if she is, I know how much Brian adores you. That is, it's just warms my heart when you talk about your mom and know how much you love her. You love both of your parents.
I do. I love both of them.
Of course you do. But, you know, it's you're very fortunate to have that relationship. And I just know you talk like every day, right?
Yes. I've actually talked to my mother. I've talked to my mother every day for at least the last 15 years.
Yes. And I've had the pleasure of meeting your mom a few times. And she just is warmth.
She is
just warmth.
Yes, I'm very lucky.
You just want to wrap her up and take her home.
Yeah.
Right. So let's look at some photos. I think we have wedding photos and some photos of your parents. Let's go right on to that.
Okay. Yes, that's their wedding
photo. What a handsome couple.
Yes. Yes, they are. And very young looking. They've always been very young looking throughout their lives. I got good genes, I think.
Yes, you did, because you do not look your age either. And I hate you for it. Okay, now who, you know, we're looking at both sets of parents.
Yep. Yeah, look at that cake, the big cake. This is my parents' 50th anniversary. Mm-hmm. Which we had, even though they were living down in Florida by that time, they decided they wanted the party up in North Carolina. So we had it up there.
And so at this point, it's been 67, 68 years that they've been married?
They've been married 68 years.
Yeah, yeah. So this was a while back. And I remember your dad when he was there. And this is more current.
Yeah, this is taken within this past year.
So it's always fun as well to look down memory lane of your various stages of your childhood. I think we have some photos starting with you. It's about 6 months old. Oh, we got this too.
This one was the latest photo. This was actually taken this October, just a couple months ago. We took our masks off for 2 seconds so that we could take this photo.
Right.
Gary and I traveled up for my father's 90th birthday. So this was actually on his birthday.
Yeah, bless him. That's wonderful. So great. And I know it's going to be unfortunate not to be with them for the holidays. I know that's going to be tough for you.
But it's more important for everyone to be safe.
Yes. Yes, sir. So let's look at some. There we go. I love this. I want a copy of this. Was this 6 months?
6 months, yeah. I was a happy child.
You? Yeah. What happened? That's good. Oh, I love this. Look at that.
I guess I was a year old.
Are any of these framed at your house?
No. No, they're not.
Okay.
Yeah.
Who cut your hair? I need to know who cut your hair, Brian.
I'm sure my dad did. He would cut it.
He put the bowl on the top of your head?
I don't know. I primarily remember him giving us, crew cuts, on the back porch with the.
Yeah, I remember my grandfather used to give us haircuts. Yeah. Go out in the garage with and just buzz us.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. I guess I was allowed to let my hair grow a little more this year for some reason.
And yeah, I think you have teeth. I can't tell there.
Yeah, I'm sure I had teeth by then. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh gosh.
Still the same haircut. It looks like a helmet.
Yeah, I know. It's like a bowling ball. I did. From this one, I skipped the chunky years. This was the beginning of it.
I've only known you when you've been fit, so it's hard to believe that you were a little chunky as a child.
Yeah, well, I didn't want to give you any visuals to.
Okay, so the clarinet. What grade is this?
This is probably ninth or tenth grade.
And you did not keep up with the instrument, right?
I did not. I still have it. Yeah, I played it through high school. I thought about continuing it in college, but I just didn't. I really, yeah. But I do miss it. I loved it very much. And
were you in the marching? Obviously, it looks like you're in the marching band.
Yes, we had a symphonic band and a concert band. Symphonic one being the higher level of music. And I was in the symphonic band for all 4 years. I placed into that one all 4 years.
Right.
And I was the first chair of the clarinet section for my last 2 years.
Yeah.
I did love it. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Now, obviously, you must explain this, right? So, I don't think you're getting dressed for school.
No, my first job was working at the ice cream parlor in the mall, and this is my uniform, which was the tricolor zip front polyester shirt with matching.
Was this Baskin Robbins?
It was Bressler's.
Okay.
The competition, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, okay.
With the matching golf cap, yeah. Yeah.
This is a great photo.
I guess that's my senior photo.
That's a nice photo. That one's a keeper.
Yeah, it's all right.
And you said let's go on to some of the other family photos. We're going to be introduced to your brothers, which are Michael and Robert.
Yes. Also known as Mick and Bob. They were Mickey and Bobby when they were little, but now they're grown men. So they're Mick and
now
Bob.
And now Michael is in is a facility engineer in Ethan Allen, right?
He is, yes. He actually ended up with the same profession that my father was in. And they for a certain amount of time, they both worked for the same furniture company, Singer Furniture, the furniture right. division of the Singer Corporation. They were both facilities engineers.
And Robert is an operations manager now at a convention center.
At a convention right? center in Hickory, North Carolina, which is just down the road from Lenoir.
All right, so your mom has a lot of hair here.
Yes.
And I think we see the through line throughout this is she has a lot of hair. And look at that. Of course, that's very much the style of the period.
I know.
And where were you here?
I'm not sure where we were. I honestly don't remember. I don't recognize that yard at all.
Yeah, it looks more like a park.
Yeah, maybe. Mm-hmm. Yeah, maybe we were camping. Could be. This is much later. This is, I think, 1980. As if you couldn't tell from the suits. Yeah.
Yeah, I think it looks like 1980.
So I was a senior in high school. Yeah. I don't look like I'm a senior, but I was.
But it definitely looks like you. You talked about a very special two families growing up, the Lamberts and the Drummonds. You want to talk about them?
Yeah, not everybody is lucky enough to have friends, you know, for the majority of their lifetime. But I was. With these two families. The Lamberts we met first when I was 3 years old, when we were living in North Vernon, Indiana. Our fathers worked together, and we lived around the block from one another as families. So their family consists of the parents, Jim and Shirley, and they had two daughters. The older one, Kelly, and the younger one, Leslie. Kelly's 3 years older than me. Leslie is only 5 months older than me. The interesting thing about our situation was that Leslie was born as a twin, and her twin brother unfortunately died about 3 or 5 days after they were born.
Oh, jeez.
So we met when we were both 3 years old, and I just sort of replaced him.
Okay. And you've stayed close ever since, right?
Yes, our families are still very close. I consider her and Kelly my sisters.
And you were like vacationing together with both of that kind of thing?
Oh, we did, yes. Yeah. Our families visited one another practically every month for years. You know, it would take turns going back and forth for a weekend.
Oh, that's great. Yeah. That's great. I think we have a photo of you and Leslie. Well, this is also with Kelly.
That's Kelly.
So is Leslie the one, and is Kelly the one in the middle?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think the picture before this one is me and, this is me and Leslie when I was living in New York, which was the late 80s. She came to visit me. So, yeah.
So what is Leslie doing now?
She is here in Florida. She lives in Deltona. Mm-hmm. She works for, she works for in Sanford, there is an airport where they do pilot training, and she works in the department for parts and services for the trainees,
right? Basically.
But for many, many years, she was actually a printing press operator. She used to run those enormous room-sized printing machines. I don't know how she did it, but right. She was really good at it.
So what were you like as a child?
I think I was basically pretty happy. As I said, I was very close to my to my parents. They both equally did things with me. My mother and I used to do a lot of arts and crafts kind of projects together. My father, part of his job as a facilities engineer, especially when he was in the furniture industry, part of his job was setting up the floor plans, the layouts of the furniture showrooms. Mm-hmm. So I remember him having all of the templates of how to draw out the, you know, where the sofa and the chairs and the tables, you know, on the floor plan. And I was always fascinated with that. And I always played with all of those, all of his drawing tools.
Right. I want Bruce to look. I think we missed a photo of one of the first costumes you made when you were younger for, I think, one of your nieces. So I'm going to look for that photo. But what hobbies? Do you have any hobbies or other interests in your childhood?
Well, like I said,
let's talk about this first.
That's my niece, Jennifer. It was one of my one of the first Halloween costumes I made for her. I made her costume most of the years as she was growing up, and she now has a son of her own, and I've been helping out with coming up with costumes for him. he's
how,
gonna be nine.
How old were you here?
Let's see. I was living in New York by that point. Let's see, 27.
Okay, so this is the point where you're already through college and you're...
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Okay, so let's go back to... we're talking about your childhood and some of your hobbies and other interests.
Well, we didn't touch on the other family that I grew up with.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
I don't think we have any photos, but the Drummonds were another family that we met early on. By the time we were living in Lenore, I think I was maybe 10 years old. Our fathers, again, worked together, and our parents were on a bowling team together. So I would go every Friday night with my parents to the bowling alley, and then I became friends with their daughters, one of them being closer in age to me, Tanya. She's probably watching tonight. and her older sister, Teresa. And then later on, they had a younger sister, Tiffany. So, and our families have remained friends all this time.
Right. So now let's go back to the other question about hobbies and other interests you had in your childhood.
Well, like I said, my mother and I used to go and take classes in different arts and crafts things. I know that I remember going for drawing lessons on Saturdays. We just did things
I saw a message from Tanya. A message from Tanya just popped up. I think she said that you were 9 and I was 8 when we met.
Wow, that young. Oh, okay.
Hello, Tanya.
Hi, Tanya.
Okay, so you did all... There was an interesting story. You did all this moving, and you said it didn't really impact your childhood because you were relatively young. But I want... There's a story about your paternal grandfather was Kiev, but yet your name is O'Keef. How did that happen?
Right. As far as I know, from what I've been told and from what I remember... yes, our whole family, his whole family had the last name Keefe. But I think when he was about 17, for some reason he had to locate his birth certificate. I think it was probably when he was wanting to join the Navy. He wanted to be a frogman. He was an excellent swimmer. And so he had to find his birth certificate. And that's when he discovered that they had made a clerical error on his birth certificate and added the O apostrophe. So we're the only branch of the family that is O'Keef. It's very, very unusual.
What an interesting story. Often in our childhood, we have these traumatic experiences that impact our adult life. And I was really taken by the story of when you were in first grade and you were part of a program called Head Start. Talk to us about that and the impact that that had on you.
Yes. As a matter of fact, I just brought this up probably for the first time in discussion with my parents only about 10 or 12 years ago. I was just prior to first grade, I was enrolled in a program. It was a government, I guess it's sort of a government social work program called Head Start for children from lower income households. And it's a 6-week program that you go through just prior to first grade. And it's supposed to help get you used to being around other children and, you know, just sort of get you prepared for going into the school system. And I remember, so I was maybe five years old. And I remember that at the end of the 6-week program, all the kids were going to be in some type of show. And all the parents were going to come and watch all their kids in the program. But about a week and a half before the end of this 6 weeks, they sent a letter home to my parents explaining that they had made an error and that our household income was actually above the maximum for being in the program. And therefore, they would let me continue the rest of the program, but I wouldn't be allowed to be in the show.
Yes.
But we were welcome to come and watch the show. So, which we did. And I can feel myself in the seat watching the show right now, now.
And how did that feel?
Well, to a 5-year-old, all I understood, all my brain understood was, you're not good enough to be in the show, but you can watch. So I didn't really even realize how that would impact me throughout my life. But it was only until, you know, I was an adult, you know, for some length of time before I reconnected to that experience. And I realized that it sort of informed how I held myself and how I perceived myself and maneuvered through life situations, school situations, career situations. So I feel that it sort of compelled me to always do the absolute best I could do at any given project.
No matter what you do, it's not quite...
Exactly. Right. So it's always striving for perfection. Yeah.
Yeah. So you never get self-satisfaction really at all. You know,
it's a learning process, you know, for all of us.
I have similar stories, and I know many of our colleagues, particularly many artists, have similar stories that I've heard over the years. And it makes you work harder. Makes you strive for bigger things, and your work gets better, but to never have that complete satisfaction because you're always walking around with the feeling of inadequacy.
Yeah. I think I've grown quite a bit, you know, in all of these years. You know, I think I've grown beyond it for the most part, but there's always that little thing in the back of your head that, you know, keeps sure. pushing you, you know, just sure. try a little harder.
Yeah.
I think it is as an adult now, especially after so many years of being in this career, I do find those moments where I feel like, I think I got that right this time. So
yeah, and I have to tell you, you are the best costume designer I have ever known, and I've known many, and just so fortunate to have you here, and I can't tell you that enough. So other than Head Start, were you exposed to any professional theater in your childhood?
Not really. As I grew up in, it was those other than Asheville, the other two towns were pretty small. So up in the mountains. So didn't really experience live theater. I think the first professional, I guess it was a professional production, I was maybe 11, 12. I had went on a business trip with my dad. My mother and I went with him to Atlanta, and we saw Martha Ray in a production of Everybody Loves Opal. And I always loved Martha Ray as a child. So so that was a fun
experience. Did that have an impact on you?
I don't know that it had a specific impact on me at that time. I'm not really sure. I think I had more of an impact. Looking back now, I think I had more of an impact from television.
Okay, so let's talk about that a little bit, because I know you know, we kind of poke fun at back and forth, because I know you like the old classics like the Andy Griffith Show and the Golden Girls, and you like the feel-good stuff, and that's good. That's not a criticism. But were there shows in your childhood that had a real impact on you?
Absolutely.
What were they?
Probably one of the top ones would be the Carol Burnett Show, which we still watch almost every night. I'm not kidding.
My favorite one is the Scarlett O'Hara.
Oh, yeah.
And the Tim Conway doing the dentist.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
But I think that particular show and the other ones, the other variety shows of the time, I think on a subconscious level, I was sort of soaking in that all of the visuals, you know, because I look back and think, wow, how amazing Bob Mackie has been, you know, throughout his career. And I've always admired his work.
Right. And
I think my, especially when it comes to musical theater work, my work tends to look a little more in the direction of his.
Right.
Yeah.
So soon you're going to decide to go to university, but I understand that costume design was not necessarily on the radar yet. And I was quite surprised to learn some of the directions you were considering. So talk about that.
So when I was still in high school, I really didn't, I didn't have a clear idea of what career I wanted to go into. My father had always had aspirations of being a dentist, which he never pursued that. So he just said, well, that's a good profession. You could go in that direction. And then if you don't like it, then you can just change your mind, you know, and come up with something else. But, you know, since you don't have a particular direction, that's a good path to start on. And I was good in science and math and all of that. So I was accepted at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. And I started out as a chemistry major. So I was on the path to being a dentist.
Herbie wants to be a dentist. that didn't last too long, did it?
After the first year, I really decided, you know, this isn't quite right. I was good at chemistry, I was good at calculus, you know, but it just didn't make me happy. So the thing that did make me give me some joy in college was language. I had taken French in high school, and I was continuing it in college. So I decided to switch to being a French major and even added Spanish. And for a while, I was sort of double majoring in French and Spanish. Neither one of them do I speak today.
I was going to say, are you fluent in either language?
I'm not. You know, you really, if you don't use it, you lose it, you know.
Yeah, and I know at university there was a very special man. I think his name was Randall. Is that correct?
Yes, Randall Keenan.
And he was really influential in changing your direction, right?
Yes.
Let's talk about Randall.
He was the first person I met in my dorm. My first day at college, he walked over and introduced himself to me, and we became friends immediately. He lived across, you know, sort of across the hall from me. And he actually lived, his room was, I think it was the same room that my oldest brother lived in when he was a freshman 10 years earlier.
Wow.
So anyway, Randall was, he really became a catalyst for who I have become as an adult and, you know, as a professional. He was the first person, he was the first person I came out to. He came out to me. So we confided in each other. We were very close. But the one thing that he did that sort of changed my path was he was in the habit of volunteering as an usher at the theater on campus. Well, in Chapel Hill, we were very fortunate that they have a professional repertory theater housed.
That's called Playmakers Rep, right?
Playmakers Repertory. So I went along with him one night to volunteer as an usher. It was amazing. I don't remember what show it was. It was a big, splashy musical. I don't know if it was Big River or had something to do with
a
river.
Boat or something like that.
Was something, yeah.
Something with a boat.
Right. So I decided after that, I decided I needed to explore that. And I still had humanities courses to choose. So I chose some in the theater department. And one of them randomly was in the costume shop called Technical Methods. It met three afternoons a week. There was no book work. There were no tests. It was.
Oh, that's a good fit.
You went there 4 hours a day, and you basically did whatever they told you to do. I think it was a way for them to teach students some skills, but also to get some unskilled labor in, you know, helping get a show, you know, put up, you know, whether it was polishing shoes or painting shoes or cleaning the dye vat, that sort of thing.
And in theater, hands-on is the best training.
Absolutely. Yeah. So I remember there were 12 people in the class. They broke us up into groups. I went into a group where they decided to teach us how to use a sewing machine the very first day. They sat me down. I'd never used a machine in my life. They told me how it works. This is how it works. This is how the thread goes. And there was a pile of pieces of fabric. It was a costume already cut out. They said, okay, this goes together like this. And I just, it felt very natural to me.
Right.
It all made perfect sense to me. And so I started taking more classes.
The decision was made.
Yeah. And so for a while I was still hanging on to the French major because I had gotten pretty far with that.
Wouldn't you go on to Quebec?
I did. I spent the summer after my sophomore year, I did a summer immersion course up in Quebec. Yeah.
And it was still about language.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Definitely.
So we have a couple of photos of Randall, I think early on when you were at university, and then one in later years. And what the shorts. Okay, yeah. So what grade is this? What
this is our sophomore year. Our freshman year we lived in a dorm, and our sophomore year we moved in into an apartment together with two other guys. Mm-hmm. So, he was my roommate in that apartment.
And now this is some years later, a photo of Randall. And
some years later, yes.
And sadly, you learned in recent years that he has passed away.
Just this August, as a matter of fact, yeah.
Sorry to hear that.
You know, we hadn't, sadly, we did not keep in touch over the past few decades, unfortunately. I don't know. It was certainly not intentional from either one of us, but you know, people come into our lives and they leave our lives, and that's just what happened, unfortunately.
You know, when you look at a photo sometimes and you just know when a smile is sincere.
He's one of the most beautiful souls I've ever known my entire life. Yeah.
He radiates it. You know, he can just see it in the photo.
Yeah. Well, and as it turns out, he helped me further because he graduated just before I did. He graduated early and was hired by Alfred A. Knopf Publications in New York. And so he was already up in New York. And I got hired, when I got hired for a job in New York, I didn't have a place to stay. So I stayed on his sofa for the first 3 weeks until I found a place to live. So
yeah, well, that's common. Some people stay on the sofa for months and years with their friends. Yeah. But you would do work at Playmakers. Now, I know you did Romeo and Juliet. Was that the first?
Well, that was after I graduated. While I was still in school, I don't think I mentioned this to you, I guess I was a senior. They actually gave me a show to design as an undergrad, which was very unusual. Normally it went to all of the grad students in the program, but I guess it must have been a very heavy costume semester or school year. So they tried me out on a show. It was Christopher Durang's Baby with the Bathwater. Couldn't be farther from what I've done the majority of my career. But it was a show.
It was a show.
Great experience. It's a great experience. But the Romeo and Juliet, after I graduated, the following year, they actually hired me as a pattern maker. Honestly, I don't even remember how much of the show I patterned. If it was just the women's wear, I couldn't possibly have patterned the whole show. Mm-hmm. But that was doing that project is sort of what got me into New York.
So talk about that.
The designer of that production was a guest designer, a regional. Costume designer by the name of Sam Kirkpatrick. Mm-hmm. He loved my work, and he actually called his friends in one of the costume houses in New York and gave them a reference. And they interviewed me over the phone, and they hired me over the phone, which was unheard of.
and our audience may not know this, but it was called Michael John Costumes, right?
Michael John Costumes.
And then eventually you went to I think it was more known at the time, the East Brooks, right?
Yes. And in between, I also worked for Barbara Matera, which was the premier costume house in New York. And a lot of people don't realize that in New York, as a costume person, you don't work for a theater necessarily. You work for a costume company that gets contracted by the producers of any given show. So you sort of follow the work around the city, you know, whichever shop has more work to be done. So I worked in about five or six different costume houses.
Would Eves Brooks eventually become Dodger Costume? Is that right?
Yes, it started out as Brooks Van Horn before my time there. And then while I was there, it was Eves Brooks. Then it became Dodger.
I visited there when I was directing an earlier production of 1776, and I was blown away by their inventory and how they categorize right down to the decade of each century. And it was mind-blowing.
Was it in Long Island City? Did you go to Long Island City, or were they still in Manhattan?
It was not Manhattan. No.
Okay. Yeah. So that's where I worked. Yeah. Yeah. There were floors.
I was so impressed with that. So let's show a couple of photos here.
Yeah.
What are we looking at?
They had a contract, an ongoing contract with Barnum and Bailey Circus. I think that I made three of these. There were, part of one of those big production numbers in the circus, you know, where they all go around the ring. Mm-hmm. I guess it was a Latin theme for that particular number.
Right.
And then I think the next one, it was sort of a space age theme.
I say, did you raid my closet?
You were wondering where it happened, where it went to.
Wondering what the hell that thing went. And then this says you've written all over it.
This one, it's not a very good picture of it, but one thing they were contracted to do was to replicate the Scarlett O'Hara drapery dress by Franklin Mint. You know, Franklin Mint was famous for doing all the figurines, you know, the,
Right, sure.
The collectible figurines. And at the time, they were opening their very first retail store, I think it was in Baltimore, and they wanted, and one of their new figurines was Scarlett in the green velvet dress, and they contracted Eves Brooks to make a life-size version of it for the display window in the new store. So I got to make that.
And I'm sure I can tell the photo doesn't do it justice. And and you know how I feel about green. I would love to. Love green. But you're missing the curtain rod.
Right.
So, I ask this of everybody who's on the show. Did you have a mentor? Somebody you regard as a mentor?
Well, you know, my professors, my teachers at Chapel.
There was no one person that.
Well, there were two there specifically. Well, three. I take it back. There were three. My design professor for the majority of the time there, her name is Bobby Owen. She's now retired. She became a dean later on. I just loved her work. I loved her style of design. The second person would be Judy Adamson. She was brought in to run the shop and be the head pattern maker. It turns out that she was... She's probably the most amazing pattern maker I've ever come across in my entire career. Mm-hmm. She was also the right-hand woman to Barbara Matera in New York. Mm-hmm. So she would go back and forth. So by the time I was living in New York after I graduated, it sort of helped me get my foot in the door at Matera's because she was there. She was second in command.
Is there a designer that you most admire?
Well, I'd probably have to go back to Bob Mackie because, you know, I tend to approach things a lot like he did. Yeah.
What do you like most about being a costume designer?
Probably the thing I like most is that every project is different. Mm-hmm. You know, it's even if it's the same show and you've designed it before, it's still different because it's a different time in your life. It's a different set of actors. It's a different director. The other designers you're collaborating with are different, most likely.
What is your greatest challenge as a designer?
Probably the fact that every show is different.
and working with different directors. Do you find that your process, we'll get a little bit in the process later, does your process change from director to director?
It does. If I've worked with a particular director more than once. You know, my initial approach to a project and its director is always going to be the same until you know who you're working with, you know, how you interact and so it is different, you know.
You know, I was just realizing I have a similar relationship with you that I do with Sue Ellen. You know, when we're decorating the house, I really don't have any say. That she will pick two pieces of furniture that she likes and both are acceptable to her. And then she'll ask me which one I like and make me feel like I'm part of the process. and you kind of do the same thing. You get fabrics that you know that I would probably you really pick them that both of them will do. And then you say, Bill, which one do you like? And you say, and they both are acceptable to you. So you make me feel like I'm part of the process, but I'm really not.
Yeah, you are. Yeah. I don't think we do that every time, but
no, but we're fortunate that I think you and I have a really good, working relationship and a shorthand, and, you do know what I like. So you have that advantage when you've worked with me or Barry or somebody for a lot of years.
Well, I've definitely done more shows with you than anyone else here. We've done 19 productions together.
But who's counting? I'm blessed. I'm fortunate. And I probably shouldn't put this on tape, but of course you are my preference. So I wouldn't have it any other way.
Very kind.
I trust you completely. Now, while you're in New York, soon you would decide there's going to be another change. I want to talk about your route to Florida.
Oh, boy. Okay. So I was in New York for 3 years, after that, I ended up going back to North Carolina for a year on my way to Florida, and that just had to do with my partner at the time that I had met.
Which wasn't Gary.
Who wasn't Gary, who got a job at the hospital in the town near where I grew up. So we moved there. That relationship did not last. So I had to make a decision what I was going to do next. And by that point, Leslie, my best friend Leslie, was living in Orlando. So in talking to her, we realized that we'd always wanted to live near each other again, because we had been separated geographically for many years by that point. So I flew down to Orlando. I lined up three job interviews, and I accepted one. And I moved there. And we were roommates for 3 years. And I was actually hired as a designer.
And it was a Seaside Music Theater?
No, this was the Mark II Dinner Theater.
Oh, okay. I didn't know that part. And so you would end up Seaside Music Theater, which is now unfortunately defunct, was for a long time in Daytona Beach. Big theater, did straight plays, but really known for doing big extravaganza musicals.
Yes.
Gary was one of the superstars there. Gary, we're mentioning you. That's the first time I mentioned Gary.
But he'll get mentioned more as we get into Seaside.
Okay, we'll mention more about Gary, so don't you worry, Gary. Yeah. But he was a superstar there, as were you. But how many years were you at Seaside?
I was there for 16 years. After when I left the dinner theater, Seaside hired me as a pattern maker for part of a season. And then they hired me again the following season. I did custom upholstery in between those two summers, among other things. And then they kept me on. They hired me as the sort of assistant shop manager and resident pattern maker.
Was it around the same time that Gary was being introduced to the theater or not?
He had been acting there before me. Yeah. I think his first summer was, I don't know, 88, yeah.
Yeah.
So my first summer was 92. So, yeah. And then by the time we get to 94, they asked me to design for them.
You had a huge operation there. You had a staff. You had a huge shop. You were doing rentals. You were doing other display work in the community. Talk about your responsibilities there.
Yeah.
It was pretty significant.
Yeah. By 95, the shop manager and resident designer decided to move on. She got married and moved away, and I took her place. It really was a massive operation. The costume shop was also a national rental business. We went, at the time, we were 5,500 square feet for the costume shop. And shortly thereafter, we doubled in size. So my shop was 11,000 square feet.
You had quite an adjustment coming to Dramalogue.
Right. Yeah, I remember the first time I showed up, your sewing...
And you're sewing in your garage.
Your sewing equipment consisted of one of those travel sewing kits.
And your parents and Gary are sewing in the garage.
Oh yeah. But yes, I had 4 year-round employees, and then our big season up there was the summer. We did 5 main stage productions and then 1 theater for young audience production that ran on Saturdays.
I guess I didn't realize that. Was it a subscription base or was it just...
It was.
Yeah, but it was summer mostly.
Yes, we had a winter season as well, but it was usually only 3 productions on a much smaller scale than what the summer was.
Well, that's so unusual for Florida.
Yeah, it's completely backwards. Yeah, completely.
Well, I guess it makes sense because it's northern Florida and it's a little bit different climate. Yeah.
Right. Well, yeah. So we did all the big musicals. We did operas, operettas. In the winter season, we would generally do a classic play like Great Expectations or a Shakespeare. And then a couple other, usually a musical and a review or something like that.
Did you design all the shows?
I didn't, thankfully. I don't think I'd be alive if I were.
Well, I was going to say, because they did such huge shows, but...
Well, for a summer season, I would generally design 3 out of 6, and I was also the lead pattern maker at the same time.
You did pick the ones you were going to do?
I did, yeah, and a lot of the times it didn't necessarily have to do with what I wanted to do. It had to do with how the season laid out, you know, logistically, production-wise, because we manufactured almost everything.
Right. So we certainly can't show everything you've done there, but we're going to show photos of a few highlights and some of your favorites. If you want to talk us through some of these photos,
sure. So this was West Side Story. I had to throw that in there only because Gary's the one right in the middle. He played Riff. I think you saw this.
Is there anything Gary can't do as a performer? Jeez, he's a triple threat.
Yeah,
right.
He can do everything.
Yeah.
So that was the first show that I designed there, West Side Story. And that was when I first met Gary in his costume fitting. This is a production of Twelfth Night, one of our winter season productions. Yeah.
Is this Gary?
No. No. This was Seaside's production of The Little Foxes. And I don't know if you can make the connection here, but this is Regina's last costume. And I stayed with my same color palette for our production.
Yeah.
Which is interesting, revisiting a piece of work, you know, 20 years later.
Right.
This was, of course, Hello, Dolly. And this was the opening number.
Do you remember, who's the actress who's playing Dolly? Because she looked awfully familiar.
That's Elizabeth Murph.
I know.
Very, very dear friend out of Orlando. Amazingly talented. This is from our production of Sweet Charity. This is our dear friend Lizzie. She must have been 6 feet tall. She played every tall showgirl that we needed in any given production. She was in Sweet Charity. She is Ursula, who is the girlfriend to Vittorio Vidal, the film star that Charity runs into and ends up going into the Pompeii Club. This was his girlfriend, his mistress. This is a sketch of Domina from A Funny Thing Happened on the Way to the Forum. I don't know if you can notice all of the detail of the gold work and all the vine work and all that sort of the cross hatching, the lattice work. All of the costumes for the show, that work was done by hand-painted stencils.
And just so the audience knows, as part of the design process, is Brian does rendering sketches for every single design.
Yeah, and I think the next slide is the real thing. Yeah. and there we have Gary again.
Oh.
Yeah, he played Hysterium.
Yeah.
And he was hysterical.
Of course.
Yeah. This one I had to throw in. It was one of my favorite shows for our theater for young audience. You're a Good Man, Charlie Brown. It's a show that makes me happy every time I think about it. But it was fun to create those characters.
I think it still holds up, and it really doesn't get done.
No, not very often.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is from our production of Elton John's Aida, and the lady in the center is Amneris, who is the Egyptian princess, and this is during a number called My Strongest Suit, because she was known for her fashion sense. So it was sort of a musical Egyptian fashion show,
right.
Quite elaborate. That was a lot of fun. This is Beauty and the Beast.
Of course.
Yeah, it was. We did it twice, as a matter of fact. The first time it was the last show of that summer. So following five other productions, we decided, because it was so massive, I would co-design it with one of our regular guest designers, Stacey Galloway. And we divided it by having her design the humans, and I designed the objects and the creatures, and it worked very well. This is from our production of Follies. I think this was the second show I designed there, co-designed with the shop manager at the time. This is from the number, it's called the Loveland sequence. There are six of them. Each themed differently. And those huge skirts were welded metal frames that the scene shop did for me. Very heavy. This is a sketch of the saloon girl, the dance hall girls in the Dream Ballet of Oklahoma, which is a lot of fun. One of my favorite shows.
Yep.
It's an amazing, wonderful musical. And I think the next slide is...
Have you ever performed?
Not really professionally. I've sung here and there, mm-hmm. For benefits. When I was in that summer immersion program in Quebec, I was part of the chorus there. I was part of the Orlando Gay Chorus for a season. When I was in high school, for some odd reason, one of the clubs, I did a variety show, and I did, with my friend Mariella, she and I did the Abbott and Costello routine of Who's On First.
Who's On First, yeah. So I want your version of how you and Gary met. I want to know if it matches Gary's version, and who asked who out.
Well, as I said, the first time we met was in 1994 in his costume fitting for West Side Story, mm-hmm. And he was also in Follies that year. And did you do another one that year? Was that also a chorus line? I didn't design that one, but so you know, at the time he was another actor, just one of the dozens and dozens of actors and performers we had for the summer, and he didn't live there. He was just brought in for the season, and then he was brought back and joined the staff 3 years later. You were there. He came back for another season, he joined the staff in 97, and in 98, by that point, I was unattached. he called me up one day, and he knew that I used to go out dancing a lot, so he wanted to know if there was a group of people going out dancing. And I said, well, no, but I'll go. So we went out on a date.
You know, I said this when we're having my discussion with Gary, and what I've over the years have seen in both of you is how much you not only love each other, but respect each other and admire each other's work. And I know when you see him on stage, you know, you come into the lobby and you're beaming him as an artist. And it's just so clear how much you respect and love each other.
Well, you know, I mean, he's you've only seen him in two productions here at Dramaworks. You know, I've seen him in dozens of shows, and mm-hmm. and so I know all of those sides of his performing abilities, and he never ceases to amaze me. He just runs the gamut. I mean, he can do
he sure does.
Shakespeare. He can tap dance. You know, I mean, it's yeah. And we've also had many years of working together with him as director, and me as film designer.
I'm good at that too. And how many years have you been together now?
We're coming up on 23.
Wow, that is much longer than most marriages. That is wonderful. So unfortunately, Seaside closes down. I don't remember what year that was.
2008.
2008. Yeah.
By that point, I had been there for 16 years.
And I know that was a hard pill to swallow.
It was hard, yeah.
Yeah.
I designed, I think the last time I counted, it was somewhere around 82 productions myself.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I know that was really hard on you because I'd known you shortly thereafter. And so let's talk about prior to PBD, life after Seaside.
Well, there wasn't that much time in between, actually, because Seaside closed in August of 2008. Gary got a job at Orlando Repertory right away, and I started freelancing locally and also in Alabama. I went to Alabama Shakespeare quite a bit, but it was January of 2009 that Mike Amico called me, and after I had sent my resume and portfolio, he called me and said, you needed a designer. I don't know if Aaron was supposed to have someone. I think somebody was already slated to do the show, and they, for some reason, couldn't. So it was a last minute thing. It was the production of The Weir.
Yeah, Erin was doing a lot of our designs initially, but she wasn't always available at the time. The kids were young. The kids were in school. She had many obstacles, especially with Michael not being home quite often. So it was a challenge for her, and we didn't have a backup person. So you had submitted resumes throughout the state of Florida?
Mm-hmm. That's right, yeah. And he recognized my name because he had been a guest set designer for us at Seaside a few years back.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And you had not heard of Dramaworks prior to that, I'm sure, because we were a really young company at the time. But it was a real challenge for you to be a freelancer because you're really kind of a homebody, aren't you?
I am. I am very much. I'm sort of in the wrong business altogether for my basic personality makeup.
You'd still be a dentist.
I could, I suppose. I was sort of thrust into the world of freelance, and that was mainly because, partly because Gary, you know, fortunately was hired right away and had a job, but we had also just built a house, a month. We closed on the house a month before the theater closed. So we, you know, all of a sudden, and it was 2008, the year that the housing market crashed. So,
and then I botched that all up again when I wanted the movie down here. Right. I remember early on, we would actually have design meetings while you were in your car on your way to Alabama, right?
Yeah, well, the first show with for The Weir, Jay Barry directed it. Mm-hmm. We had our design meeting while I was driving to Alabama to pattern one of their shows. Yeah. And I worked on gathering the costumes for that show while I was in Alabama, and then came down and put the show up.
We also had a, you didn't have an official shop anywhere at this point. So you had your own makeshift shop, right? That you
was in your garage? We turned our garage into my workshop. For most of the time, it was only on one side of the garage, my side of the garage. But in this case, as you see in the photos here, I sort of kicked Gary out of the garage completely. this was during the time that I was building our production of Les Liaisons Dangereuses, which is a massive show, massive costume show.
Yes, I remember my life was threatened.
Yeah, there's the other side of the garage. My cutting table, yeah. And these photos were taken on Christmas Day, I think, and the show was opening at the beginning of February. So, you know, I was weeks away from having to be down there with the show ready for fittings. So
you went from a seaside, and there we even put your husband.
So on Christmas Day, this is Gary cutting the metal bones for the bodices. And I think the next one is my mother pressing and rolling fabric, bolts of fabric. And then I think the next one is my dad grinding the tips of the metal bones.
I have tremendous guilt that I never paid your family to do this. and you would spend like 6 years working out of the garage, right?
Basically.
With no AC in the summers?
No AC, no heat. Because it does get cold in Daytona Beach.
Yeah.
Yeah, but, you know, you do what you have to do.
And then I think it was around 2015 that we were ready to grow up here at Dramaworks. And I asked, of course, you had a new home. And I asked you to fill a position full-time here at Dramaworks as resident costume designer. At that time, it wasn't costume shop manager because we still didn't have a costume shop. Was that a hard decision for you?
It was. You actually gave me a year to think about it. And I took... I don't think you remembered that part.
I think that's generous.
It was very generous. But, I mean, the most surprising thing is that you actually did wait that long for my answer.
But I seem to think
my
recollection too, I think early on that I always knew that I wanted to expand education, and I knew Gary's reputation in the state. And I think there was even much advanced notice on that as well to say, we want to eventually do this, right?
Right. Yeah. I think it just took a little bit of time, I think, for you as a company to get closer to the ability to bring him on eventually as well. Mm-hmm. So that the two can coincided. I mean, they were closer together in time, so we weren't maintaining two households for too long.
Yeah, and I want to reinforce what I said with Gary. It is a coincidence that you two happen to be a couple, that you had a supreme reputation as a designer, again, the best I've known. And Gary had long before I even met Gary, I knew of his reputation in the state of Florida with education. And as I said before, Sharon Long, who's the executive director of FIPTA, was always talking about how brilliant Gary was on stage, and then talking about the two of you. So, just fortunate to have you both. Let's talk a little bit, and I know it's hard to put in a nutshell, but so the audience understands, what is the basic design process?
Well, it starts with a script, of course. You know, when I get a script, I go through it and I extract all of the information, whether in the dialogue or in the stage direction, that has anything to do with anything that anyone could possibly be wearing or carrying or anything that relates to what's on their body. And then I generally create an outline using that information, scene by scene, who's in each scene, if there's a description of what they're wearing or whether they're removing something, adding something, I document all of that. I'm a bit of a nerd when it comes to making lists. So
I make multiple
lists in different formats. Sometimes I will create a spreadsheet of color palettes for characters from one scene to another so that I can look at, a collection of three different colors for this character's costume next to these three colors on the next character so that I can look at the whole color spectrum for that scene and decide how to balance the colors, you know, across the board, you know, during that scene, since they're all up on stage together. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, it's a matter of doing a lot of research. We do a lot of period shows here, of course. So involves doing research and meeting with the director and talking about the specifics, you know, of the director's concept, which direction to go in, color palettes. Then it goes into fabrics and finalizing the designs for things. If it is a show that requires designing and building as opposed to a contemporary show, and it goes from there. And if it is a show that I'm building costumes for, then of course that involves finding all of the fabrics and trims.
Yeah, I think that's, you know, I was just going to say, you know, we do a lot of period shows, and I know that has been a great source of frustration for you over the years to find the right fabrics, especially in Florida.
It's a challenge. It's a big challenge, yeah.
Yeah, and I know that when you worked in Daytona, you used to make fabric trips to New York.
We would go, I would meet the other guests, the guest designers for that season in New York in February. We would be up there for 2.5 weeks shopping for fabrics for the entire upcoming season and have it all shipped back. Mm-hmm. It was a massive undertaking.
No, I was.
We generally built, 400 or 500 costumes a season.
You know, I was sitting here thinking too, not in just costume design. When we're trying to think of a show outside the box, in making a whole conceptual, you know, unique choice. For example, when I was working with Clive Charlton to do 1776 and Sweeney Todd to take an entirely different approach to it.
Yeah.
You were instrumental in helping us find it. And how to do that and pull it off. And I know it was frustrating for all of us, but you were a huge part in finding those plays.
Well, I particularly loved 1776 as a project in the way that we did it, because, you know, doing a play of real historical characters, you know, 26 of them, I believe, 24, 26 of them, but doing it with only 13 actors, trying to figure out how to make that make sense visually and stylistically, you know, from a directing standpoint.
Yes, it only worked if you made a completely unique stylistic choice for the piece and not the way it was originally intended.
Yeah.
You know, and you were also fortunate because your partner had the leading role as John Adams. That made it extra special.
Yeah.
So you have... obviously, we can't show all the productions you've done here because it's 51 productions, but you did say there are 13 that you regard as maybe your favorites.
Some of my favorites, yeah.
Some of your favorites. And we're going to talk about these 13 productions. And I'd like to know what made them unique and challenging and ultimately gratifying for you. So okay. We're going to start with back in the little space when we did Private Lives. Let's first look at a sketch you did in university here. Let's talk about the sketch.
So when I was in college, one of our design class projects was Private Lives. It wasn't realized or anything. It was just a sketch project. And so these are the two ladies in the first scene.
And they had very long necks.
Yes, it was I was going for a very Art Deco.
I know what you're doing.
Yeah.
So then
this was for our production. This is Amanda in the first scene, and then the next one is Sybil. Oh, well, that's the photo of her.
Look how beautiful that dress is. Yeah.
But it's interesting that I decided to stick to that color palette that I settled on back in college, just because.
Was that what made it special, is for sentimental reasons?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And this is...
That's Sybil, yeah. And I think there's a real picture of her as well.
Yep.
So it was nice to you know, realize that, even though it was so many years later. Mm-hmm. And in a different period.
And the next one, which is probably our first huge undertaking, and that was A Doll's House, which was, I think, our first period show, right?
It was, yeah.
And this starred Marjorie Lowe is Nora. And let's talk about this process for you.
It wasn't our first show working together, but I think it was definitely our first period show working together. Mm-hmm. I think that's where we really, the two of us, learned about each other and what our strengths were and what our preferences were, and our visual aesthetics were. So mm-hmm. I love that show. It's of course character driven. So I love creating. I love a show that has not too many characters. You know, there are just enough that, and there is enough time that passes within the story that you actually get to create the wardrobe for these people.
And it was a huge undertaking for us at the time because we didn't have the facility or the help. And did you make this mostly in your? You didn't make this in your garage, though. You made this. Didn't you build this in the back room of the theater?
Well, I finished it in the back room. Yeah, once I was here. Well,
let's look at some photos of the beautiful outcome here. And there is Miss Lowe and Michael St. Pierre.
Yep.
It's just stunning. And of course, this is where you learn that I like green.
You liked green, yes.
And now you see why. And Nanique Gridian, who gave a fabulous performance as well here.
Right, yeah. And she's with the nurse.
Beverly Blanchett
as the nurse.
Green dress.
Yeah. And then that's her Tarantella costume.
Gorgeous.
That was a lot of fun.
Yeah. And then...
Yeah, that's actually her at the very beginning of the play.
Yep.
When she first comes in from shopping.
Yep. Christmas shopping. Mm-hmm. Jeez, it is too bad that we only use that one. Somebody will want to buy that. tell me why dancing at Lunasa was one of the top shows for you.
As a project, it was interesting. As I said before, with A Doll's House, you know, it is character driven, but, and you know, it's a small number of characters, but more specifically for this one, being a period show, I believe it's 1930, It's in the 30s in a small rural town in Ireland, and it's a family of five sisters, and their older brother eventually when he shows up, or was he already there at the beginning? I don't remember.
Father Jack shows up within the play.
Yeah. Okay. So I think what made it interesting as a project is creating the wardrobe for this unit of family members in a small town, and trying to figure out how to make them look real and how to differentiate them one from the other based on their personalities or their status within the household. Mm-hmm.
So. Now you and I have talked several times about a major shift you made from Seaside Music Theater to Palm Beach Dramaworks, and you viewed it as an evolution and period for you.
It was. Well, and that was part of, that came out of our collaboration right away, especially on Adult House, because, my natural instinct was, to add more embellishment, and you kept saying no. Let's simplify that. Let's pull back on that. Pull back until it, in the end, then it really looked like real clothing.
And in some, was it going from making it beautiful to making it real? Is that a fair statement? In some cases, for example, when you did the Beauty Colleen of Lenan. Right?
Right.
Yeah. And I kept saying,
that's very real.
And I said, it looks too good. You need to make it grungy. It needs to be tattered. It needs to be worn. Right. It was a big adjustment for you.
I mean, we did do some period classic shows at Seaside, but it wasn't the norm. So. Mm-hmm.
Let's show some photos from Lunas. I think we have a couple to show.
We have a few, yeah. Yeah, the sisters, yeah.
Aaron Joyce Schmidt, Gretchen Poirot, and Marge Lowe, and Julie Rowe. All have done several shows with us.
Yeah.
And here is...
There's Gretchen and Cliff. And that's just
Declan Mooney. Now in Ireland.
Yeah.
Where is his home? Beautiful. And let's talk about Lion in Winter, because I think what the work you did in that was just stunning and very labor intensive. So.
Yeah. during these years before I joined the staff, I continued to go back and forth between working on the shows here at Dramaworks and regularly working as a pattern maker at Alabama Shakespeare and also Utah Shakespeare. It was helpful to me specifically on this show because I learned a lot of techniques of craft work, especially for Lion in Winter. I learned all the tricks on how to make real metal crowns for our production from Jeffrey. At Alabama, that's just a wonderful period to get to do. Yeah. There aren't a lot of plays in that time period, so it was a lot of fun.
Let's look at some photos, and we might even see one of Pierre.
I know.
Yeah, let's look what we got here. This is a sketch of Eleanor.
Right.
And here she is, the real thing.
Yep.
That was and
that's Henry.
There they are. That was just, it was just good. The photos don't do it justice. It was just stunning and authentic. And were these fabrics hard for you?
They were very hard. It's hard to come up with fabrics that that look like they're extremely heavy to be worn in a castle in the middle of the winter.
And then that the actor can bear to wear it.
Yeah.
On a hot stage. And yeah. since Pierre is here, we want to show a rendering of Pierre, who would play Prince or King Philip.
Prince Philip.
Yeah, because Pierre, as you know, is a dear one on our staff, and this was his debut on our stage. Look how handsome he is. Look at that. Pierre, did you save that? Did you save all your costumes?
Listen, I know exactly where all of those costumes are in storage. And the second Brian is not looking,
Pierre, look at that one. Here's Pierre, ladies and gentlemen. And isn't Gary supposed to come in the background like you did the other day?
Maybe when we get to the end.
Yeah. And each of these just so suited to the character. That was perfect for Cliff's character too.
I know that was your favorite, I think.
Yep. And here he is with Richard.
Yeah.
Just good. Okay, Pierre, you can go.
Can I say something about my costume, though?
What?
Now, you probably don't know this, but on the fleur-de-lis of each of on my tunic, there was a hand-sewn glass bead on the center of each of those fleur-de-lis, and that's just like the kind of intensity and attention to detail that I think you always give to your costumes, and I'm just going to say that it was an absolute pleasure wearing it.
Okay.
Thank you.
Get out of this thing. Is my new co-host.
Thank you, Peter. Your check is in the mail.
Yeah. He's my Ed McMahon. And then let's go on to Dangerous. We talked about Liaison. We talked about that, but let's just show some of the photos from it because for the sake of time, let's talk about this. Again, some renderings.
Sure. Yeah. You can just roll through them. It's a massive costume extravaganza. You know, it's a large number of characters. And
look at that. Oh, my God.
Different scenes. I built as much of it as I could. I couldn't build everything, of course, but I was able to borrow and rent some things. This particular dress that she's wearing was a dress originally from Seaside Music Theater that ended up at University of Florida, Gainesville, and I borrowed it from them. So it was a combination of borrowing and renting and building as much as possible.
Just stunning. Stunning.
But I love the project. Absolutely loved it.
Yeah.
You know, 1700s, late 1700s.
And, you know, you put so much work into that. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I don't think you had much help building this, did you?
We ended up having to gather a lot of extra hands at the last minute.
Now here's a group photo. Look at that, just gorgeous.
Yeah, I love that opening tableau.
So the next one we talk about, and I'm curious why Long Day's Journey into Night was particularly special for you and what made that unique.
I think, again, it was another one of those, you know, small cast stories that is character driven, you know, just trying to get inside the minds of these characters and figure out what they would have chosen to wear, you know.
I mean, there's not many
try to make it as real, you know, just like garments as opposed to costumes.
So there weren't many costumes, but you had to be so specific on your choices.
Right. Sometimes that's harder when you don't have as many scenes in a play and there aren't as many costume changes or, you know, change of day and or time, that sort of thing. Mm-hmm. The costumes are scrutinized more because the audience members are staring at them for much, much longer than if they're changing one scene after another.
So let's look at a couple of photos. Of course, it was brilliantly directed.
Yes, it was.
Here, the lovely, this is Carrie Urban and the lovely, beautiful Maureen Enderman.
Yeah.
That was just, the dress was just perfect for her.
It was amazing.
And
there's Dennis.
Dennis Cregan.
And John Winter Thompson. Yep. And I can't
remember. Michael Stewart. Michael
Stewart. Okay. Yeah. And there's the green, the obligatory green dress.
This is one of my favorite photos from the production.
Yep.
And is there more? And let's go all right on, because we talked about 1776. Let's go right on to it.
So that's John Adams. And you'll see that he's wearing contemporary pants and shoes, and that was part of the concept. The show started out with everyone in contemporary clothing, and then they morphed into 1770s from the waist up, as far as the men were concerned.
Right. And this is Abigail Adams.
Abigail Adams and
Laura Hudos.
Laura Hudos, and she also played John Hancock. So she had to go back and forth between being Abigail and John Hancock. So this dress was built as a unit that opened up the front with magnets.
Yeah, that was just a great transition. I remember that moment on the stage. And right. Next photo.
That's a sketch of
Martha Jefferson was one of the most beautiful dresses on our stage.
I had seen this piece of fabric, this piece of silk fabric in a fabric store in Orlando, stared at it, came across it for years on a bolt in the back of the store, and then I finally had a reason to use it.
And here Mallory Newber is Martha Jefferson.
No.
It's just stunning.
Thank you.
Yeah. And I don't know if we have any more here. Oh, we do. And here is Martha now playing George Washington, which is probably
right.
Yeah.
I think Mallory played the most characters in that show. I think she played five different characters.
Yep. And now let's, again, I don't want to zoom through these too much, but let's just keep going through these photos just because the clock is ticking. Yep. Arcadia, such as Tom Stoppard's Arcadia, both you and scenic designer Anne Mundell both outdid yourselves here. The costumes and the set were just an absolute work of art. Now, we did include Captain Bryce because it was played by Gary. And we have to mention Gary at least 10 more times before we sign off.
Right.
And Marge again is Lady Croom.
Of course.
No, she's not in every show, just a lot of them. And look at this, the final outcome. This looks just stunning.
Yeah, the biggest challenges to doing Arcadia, especially on this beautiful set, is the fact that it's two stories happening on the same set, basically simultaneously. One takes place in 1809 to 1812, and then the other story is contemporary, mm-hmm. and the scenes go back and forth. But the set stays the same because it's two stories that are happening in two different periods of time mm-hmm. in the same location.
Right.
So it's like it's like designing two shows in one. But on top of that, the fact that the set design was completely monochromatic made for an interesting challenge in creating the color palettes for the characters so that they looked cohesive and balanced mm-hmm. From one scene to another and from one period to another.
Right. And with Sweeney Todd, let's talk about how we settled on the design. Again, you were very instrumental in helping me and helping Clive find this approach. I want to talk about your thinking here.
Yeah, the musical itself, the story takes place in the 1800s, and it's not necessarily very clear exactly where in the 1800s this takes place. It's a little bit vague, but it's... I wanted to, first of all, if we were to settle on it only being a specific decade within the century, that would involve a lot of building costumes, and for a summer show that was a little too much of a challenge. So, and we also decided that we wanted to make it a little more appealing to a younger audience. I have a little sexier feel to the design of the show.
Which it sure was. They flocked in for it, so it worked.
And so we introduced the element of steampunk, you know, with all of the buckles and the goggles and all the different industrial accessories and embellishments to sort of give it a cohesive feel.
Love this.
And still have a sense of a period. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, so that's the Beetle, which is definitely quite a mashup of contemporary and period. And
there we have Jim Ballard as the Beetle, and he did a great job in that, and he just looks great. It's great.
Yeah. Loved it. Loved doing that project.
And of course, we have to show Sweeney.
Yeah, and his leather apron. Mm-hmm. That's Pirelli the barber. And the judge.
The judge.
Yeah.
Which was played by Michael McKenzie. And there's the group shot. I guess this is the opening.
Yeah, I think so.
And Clive did a fabulous job with this production as well. Let's go on to The Little Foxes. We did talk about it, but I want to show some of the beautiful renderings and photos from that production. And
this is another production that that I was revisiting for me, because we did Little Foxes at Seaside and also Sweeney Todd. So it was interesting to do both of them. 20 years.
Kathy McCafferty and Frank Converse and James Andreassi and
Avery Summers.
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't see Avery Summers, who I adore.
Yep. That's the rendering for Birdie for the first scene, for the dinner scene. And there she is. When I did this at Seaside, that character was played by the wonderful Barbara Bradshaw.
Oh, right. Yeah. I think she also did it at the Caldwell, if I remember correctly.
And there's our little Caitlin, who was also in Arcadia.
Also in Arcadia. And then just a few more we're going to look at real quick. There's Woody Guthrie, directed by Bruce Linzer, one of our favorites here. God, I wish we could just keep playing this one over and over. Let's talk about this and why it is a particular favorite of yours.
Well, it's a beautiful score. I mean, it's just, the music is just so haunting and fun and playful and heartbreaking. But to create this troupe of performers to figure out how they sort of morph into one character after another in the storytelling from one vignette to another was a very fun puzzle. It really was a puzzle to try to figure out what gets taken away, what gets added as each actor, travels through the show.
Right. And the group shot.
Yeah.
And then we'd go on to a more recent show, Indecent.
And Indecent is yet another show that is a puzzle. As a designer, it's figuring out what the pieces are, what they need to be, how they need to work, whether it's, you know, making ashes pour out of their sleeves magically and having them change characters and costumes, you know, right in front of you.
Right.
That's another, yeah, definitely a great, great puzzle of a project.
And it was a humongous hit for us.
Yeah, beautiful story.
It was a great challenge to mount.
Yeah.
And I think this is was a strong image too that we used to promote the show.
Right.
Then this we actually used on a brochure cover.
For the cabaret number in Berlin. Yeah.
And then the last production you did, we're just going to touch upon it so we have time for some Q&A. Sure. Is here we have Blanche Dubois in A Streetcar Named Desire, played by Kathy McCafferty.
Right. And there she is in the beginning of the play when she's arriving. And the classic Stella. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And this is another show that I was revisiting after 20 years.
Was it at Seaside?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, it was one of our winter shows.
Anybody I know was in it?
I don't think so. Not that I can remember.
So Brian, do you have a bucket list of shows you haven't done?
You know, one thing that I... Another design class project in college was Anne of the Thousand Days, mm-hmm. of Anne Boleyn and her demise. I always thought that would be interesting to put that up on stage. One of my favorites that I would love to revisit was The Importance of Being Earnest, which I don't think we saw those photos, but anyway. It's just a beautiful play and so much fun visually.
So how do you feel that your process as a designer has changed over the years from beginning to now?
I think I have more tools in my toolkit, of course, after all of these years, and I've learned how to be a little more subtle and a little more purposeful in the design work. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Great. So Brian, we're going to open up the floor. Bruce, we're going to open up the floor to some Q&A, and thank you for spending time with me, my friend. Hello, how you doing, everybody. Bruce?
Hi. So if you have questions, look for the Q&A section and you can put them right in there. And we're going to start. Whoops, wait a second. I got to open up my participants here. We're going to start with Mary Lupo. And let me find you, Mary, to bring you in.
The Honorable Mary Lupo. I'm so glad. And I hope you and Ed Ricci are doing well and had a nice Thanksgiving.
Hi, Mary. Yep. Are you with us?
Am I there?
Hi, yes.
Ma'am. Okay, great.
Hi.
I've been intrigued for years because I try to sew. And I know how difficult it is even to set a sleeve. Or without any wrinkles or pleats in it.
Yeah, well, after 35 years, it's still a challenge to put in a sleeve.
Well, I'm just curious about a couple of things. I think I asked two or three questions. The first is, does the height and the weight and the shape of the actor or actress affect your design?
Yes, it does to a certain extent. I generally I will come up with a design and then I'll adjust it, you know, once I know who the actor is and what their size is and what their proportions are, then style lines can change accordingly.
So you don't necessarily, if you design something with a full skirt and you find a very large person who needs to wear it, you can pleat it or do alter right. it in some way.
Right. Manipulate it so that, you know, that it becomes more flattering for for who's wearing it.
When you rent or borrow a costume and you make alterations to it, do you have to return it to its original condition before you send it back?
It depends. It depends on what the costume piece is and who you're renting or borrowing from. Mm-hmm. Some places aren't concerned. If it's a suit, for example, and you've rehemmed the pants or lengthened the coat sleeves, generally you wouldn't have to restore it. But in general, renting and borrowing, you tend to do as little adjusting as possible just because it's not yours.
Well, and I want to chime in here. We find that generally when it comes to men's costumes that we're doing most of the borrowing with men's costumes, and women generally have to be custom made, right?
Right, right. Yeah. I don't consider myself a tailor. I can do tailoring, but my strengths are definitely in doing women's wear.
And my third question is, when you design the garment yourself, and you're going to construct it, do you add in inches at the seam and the hems? Do you add fabric in so that it can be altered in the future?
Oh yeah, definitely. Absolutely.
So
yeah.
What kind of range are you adding? Are you adding like from an 8 to a 12? Are you putting in that much fabric?
No, not quite. You know, I would say, you know, a size or two up, up and down, you know.
Well, thank you. Your work is outstanding and we enjoy it and we appreciate it. And I love your comment. Yes,
well, thank you.
You're correct.
Thank you, Mary. Send regards to Ed.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We have a question from Nettie. Nettie, are you with us? Nettie, you have to unmute yourself.
Yes, sorry.
There you are.
I thought it was just, something that I put down there.
Hello, yes. Nettie. How are you?
I have moved here in March. And since you started putting all these things on, I have looked at every single show and some of these Dramalogues. And I was in fashion design my whole life, so I could not miss tonight. My question is, what happens to all those beautiful costumes after the shows are finished?
We still have them. I have them. And a lot of, you know, there are some things that get reused or reshaped, yes. You know, as time goes by. You know, I've worked here for, I've been designing for 11 years now here. So I've built up our stock, you know, enormously. So, it's finally reaching a point where I can start reusing items and rebuilding them or, you know, manipulating them in some way.
And also, you know, over the 20 years, we've accumulated props and costumes and furniture, and storage becomes an issue after all these years.
It is definitely a challenge.
When things are back to normal, I'm just thinking about that now, would there be any time a chance for people who are interested in seeing those costumes close up to have?
Oh, absolutely. Yes, we have in the past. We've had various groups come through and I'd be happy to show you through.
Yes, we often do tours of we arrange tours of our costume shop and our production scene shop. Because we want to always educate the patrons on what goes into mounting our productions.
Right.
Thank you.
I live right down the street, and I hope to become a part of all the things that are going on at your drama works, because I'm very impressed. Love it. Thank you
so much, Nettie.
Thank you, Nettie.
Yeah.
We have our lovely Suzanne Jones. Suzanne, are you
with us? Ladies and gentlemen, Suzanne Jones, stage manager extraordinaire. How are you, Suzanne?
Hey, I'm good. Hi. Brian, wonderful. I just wanted to add something that people probably don't know about, is that in addition to all the work he does, all the designing, all the stitching, then there are the times that you have to bring in the actors to do all the fittings and try the costumes on and make the changes. And because of equity rules and things, Brian has to work around all of these rules. They have to be before rehearsal or during lunch break or after rehearsal. And he only has so much time. And so he'll work for 8 hours and then do 2 hours before his work starts, then 2 hours after. And that's just to fit in with the equity rules. So I just wanted to mention that beyond the work, there's hours and hours and hours of time that he puts in to make it possible for our rehearsals to run as smoothly as they can. And as a stage manager, I cannot say how much I respect that and how much I respect Brian for that.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Suzanne.
The same with all of the hair and, hair appointments that you're making and getting people dyed and dyed back and cut and
wigs. Brian loves wigs.
Yeah, my favorite.
We have a wig thing here.
Yeah.
A couple of more questions before we say goodnight.
Actually, that is all we have. So
all right.
Something is just popping
in. I'm so sorry. Somebody just popped in. I don't want to be on audio, but have to say Brian is one of the most talented and kindest designers I've ever worked with. One of my favorite humans. Curious how you imagine a character's color palette from start to finish.
Well, it really depends on what the play is, who the character is, where they are geographically, what season it is. There are so many factors involved in choosing color and texture and style line and proportion on the body. It's a lot of different factors to figure out how to make those decisions. Yeah.
Thank you, Brian. Words are not adequate to express how much you mean to me and to this organization. You've been instrumental in the evolution of this organization, and I thank you. And I look forward to many more years with you here.
Thank you. I've loved it. I've enjoyed all of these projects and working with you, especially, and Bruce. And we're a wonderful family of artists.
It does feel like family for sure.
And very honored to be a part of it.
Thank you, my friend. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to remind you Monday to get tickets for the reading of Last Night of Ballyhoo, and on December 18th, the Dramalogue with former chairman of the board and artist Mark Froberg, and a reading of the book, A Christmas Carol, on Monday, December 21st. I hope you had a wonderful Thanksgiving. I want to wish you a wonderful weekend, and there's a lot of things to look forward to in 2021. And as always, I want to remind you that love is also highly contagious. Have a good night.